Hello, how are you? We're gonna wait. Hi, I see some faces. We're gonna wait a couple of minutes to wait for everyone to get into the event. Okay, let's start. A lot of you already know me. My name is Margarita Cervera. I'm head of admissions and development at TBS in Barcelona. I hope you received the virtual kit, and if not, don't worry. We are in contact with a forwarder and you are gonna receive it very soon. We launched this initiative because we wanted to stay close to you during this pandemic situation that has prevented us to meet in person. We wanted you to live the TBS experience without traveling. We adapt to this situation. And you already received the first part. It was the virtual kit. And now we're gonna start the second part of the experience. And it's going to be with Yancy Vaillant. He's our PhD professor. And he's gonna host a workshop about an interactive workshop about entrepreneurship in higher education institutions. Be ready to participate and to learn. Enjoy it, please.
Great, good day, everyone. Okay, now that we have security distance with everybody, I will take off this so you can hear me somewhat better. My name is Professor Yancy Vaillant. I am full professor with TBS, with the Department of Strategy, Entrepreneurship, and Innovation. And I'm going to be showing you a short presentation based on different aspects of my research, the teaching, and also the consultancy, which I do with the OECD, where I work as an external consultant for their Department of Entrepreneurship, SMEs, Urban and Regions. Okay, so basically the title of what I'm going to be presenting, as Margarita has already told you, is going to be about the place of entrepreneurship in higher education institutions. It's meant to be very interactive. It's meant to stimulate thought. Some of the statements I'm going to be making are going to be intentionally provocative. It's to so we can have a debate. And in order to make it even more interactive, I'm going to ask you to get your mobile phones ready on your side. At several points of the presentation, I'm going to call on you to answer some questions, play along with your phone, and I'm going to give you the instructions when we get there. Also, if you have any comments, suggestions, questions that you have during the presentation, I would ask you to write them down, keep them aside, because at the end of the presentation, we're going to be doing a Q&A, questions and answers, and hopefully it's going to be very interactive, and I can either myself or Margarita will be able to respond and answer your doubts. Okay, first of all, a bit more about me. I'm of Canadian origins. I studied in many places of the world, first in Canada, then in Scandinavia, finally ended up my PhD studies in Spain, but also had some postgraduate studies with the MIT Sloan School of Management, especially oriented towards business dynamics, which was useful for a consultancy work I do. All my entrepreneurship education background has been learned through my collaboration with the Babson College, which is the number one school in entrepreneurship in the world for the last 27 years, according to many different rankings. TBS is a member of the Babson Collaborative, and in that state we are, at least for France, the representative of Babson College here in France, and one of the main players in Europe within that collaborative. That means that our staff is trained by Babson, our faculty. We get access to different activities, and we're continually upgrading our entrepreneurship in really the state of the art of entrepreneurship education with the collaboration of Babson. I'm involved a lot with consultancy through the OECD, the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, where I've been an external expert for over 15 years now, also collaborating with the European Commission, the Spanish and Catalan government, and I was head of the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor for over a decade. I've taught all over the world, in Europe, but also in North America, Latin America, and even in Asia at the Hiba in Syria. Okay, so why I'm describing all this is for you to get a bit of an idea of, I am just a bit of characteristic of lots of the different faculty that we have here at TBS. So TBS is a very international business school, especially our campus here in Barcelona, not in the sense that we have campuses all over the world, which we do, but mostly because it's one of the rare places where you can have an international experience by coming to our campuses, no matter where our campuses are. If you come to Barcelona, you will have professors from all parts of the world, including myself, that not only come from different parts of the world, but have different backgrounds in consultancy, in business world, and have been active in many different parts of the world. Now, that gives great diversity to the way we teach, the way we interact with the students, and finally, that diversity makes the student experience at TBS much more enriching. At least that's what we believe, and that's what we try to give our students. So that's a bit about me. Now I'm going to ask you to start this interactive part of the presentation that I was talking to you about. I'd like you to take out your mobile phone, okay? And basically, you can zoom into and scan the QR code that you have on your screen right now. Okay, I'm going to do the same at the same time that you are doing it. Okay, if you don't have the QR code scan, you can also just access through the webpage direction, the website that you have on your screen. Okay, the yellowbee.sparkup.live. Okay, and simply enter the code of the session. Okay, the code that you have on your screen right now. And what I'd like you to do when you zoom in, like here, is to answer my first question. Okay, and the first question here is, in one word, to you, what is entrepreneurship? So can you define entrepreneurship in one word, please? Okay, so please go ahead. So we already have here, somebody said that entrepreneurship is startup. Yes, startup, business creations. It's involved with the entrepreneurial events, future, entrepreneur's future, innovation, limitless. Okay, very good, limitless. And see that sort of creativity, entrepreneurship is very much associated with, you know, creativity, innovation. Okay, so you have here, innovation is coming out a lot. Okay, again, startup, business creation, collaboration, very good. Spark, okay, that idea, that spark that's coming out. Okay, very interesting. You can also, if you like some of these words, I think when you see it on your phone, you can press the heart on the side just to give that word a bit of a boost when it comes out to the word cloud. So we're seeing the word cloud that's starting to form, okay, discovering, innovation, creation, creativity. We're starting to get, you know, X factor. Okay, that's a new one. But the future, I like the future because, you know, it's something I've very thought about, you know, the future, knowledge-based economy, the 21st century is going to be very entrepreneurial, and entrepreneurial skills are going to be very important here. So, well, we have our our cloud, a new one is new ideas. That's coming in very strongly, new ideas. I'd like to change now to a new word cloud. So now we have all these main ideas for entrepreneurship. Define entrepreneurship. We have innovation, creativity, new ideas, discovering. Okay, great. Now I'd like you to go back and I'd like you to answer this. What's entrepreneurship education in one word? So to you, entrepreneurship education in one word, what could that be? If you have two words, like the ones that are on the screen, just put a dash between them. So business plan, we'll put a dash between them, and that's going to come out as one word. Okay? So go ahead. According to you, what's entrepreneurship education in one word? Okay, so motivation. So how about creative thinking? Very good. Okay. Empowerment. Okay, very good. Very good. Empowering. Flexible. Okay, we have feasibility study there. Feasibility implementation. So implementation strategy. Very boundary breaking. Okay, outside the box. Okay, it's linked with a bit of the creativity that we had before. Open. Okay, I'm seeing business plan again. Business plan, empowering, creative thinking is now the big one that's just showing in the middle. So thinking, just simply thinking, boundary breaking. Okay, this we're getting some very good answers here. My point here is to, if we look at, you know, what is entrepreneurship and what is entrepreneurship education, I mean, you have to also think now is what is should entrepreneurship education be? Because lots of the words that we're seeing on the word cloud right now, with boundary breaking, flexible, empowerment, often that's what we would like entrepreneurship education to be. But it's not always what we find when we look at the curriculums or the syllabi of many entrepreneurship education courses, you know, that in many parts of the world. And if you look at what we have as a word cloud for entrepreneurship, and now what we have for the word cloud, a word cloud of entrepreneurship education, yes, we have the creativity coming up, but it doesn't always match. Okay, so I'd like to close now this word cloud. This was mainly meant to get us thinking and put us in the context of where I'm going to go with a bit this presentation. So I'm going to close the word cloud now and go back to the presentation with, again, another question, but not another question. I just want you to think of for yourself. And it's a question that I, when I was addressing as keynote speaker just last year before the confinement, a group, an international conference of public sector efficiency economists, very tough crowd, and I was talking to them about entrepreneurship education or higher entrepreneurship education, and I put to them this question of, should higher education institutions allocate resources to entrepreneurship education, promotion, and support? Okay? We might, or most of the people might, you know, see this as, you know, of course they should allocate. But, you know, the question wasn't that obvious for that particular crowd. This is a crowd of economists trying to make sure that public sector investments and funds are as efficiently spent as possible. And for them, they don't really see that spending on entrepreneurship education, promotion, and support might be the most optimal use of higher education resources, and especially human capital. And you can a bit understand where they're coming from, because entrepreneurship in higher education is something that's very new, relatively new. 10, 15 years ago, there was very little entrepreneurship in higher education. I did my PhD, specialized in entrepreneurship, 20 years ago, a bit more than 20 years ago, and in the 90s, I did with the European doctoral program in entrepreneurship and small business management, which was a consortium of 15 different universities that together decided to have one doctoral program in entrepreneurship, because at the time, entrepreneurship was something that was too marginal to really warrant having a specific program or specific course in any one university. So these, you know, the rare birds that wanted to study entrepreneurship, you know, they all got together and formed one European doctoral program together. And that's the one I did. There was the entrepreneurship, the Indian Institute of Entrepreneurship that was started in 1987, if I'm not mistaken. And that was probably the first one in the world that brought entrepreneurship into higher education. But for the most part, entrepreneurship is less than 10 years old in most universities and higher education institutions. But it's been a boom since then. There is now entrepreneurship research chairs all over the place, all over the world. There are definitely entrepreneurship courses in almost all business schools, most universities, and now they're starting to pop up in many faculties and departments that have nothing to do with business or economics. Entrepreneurship tracks, programs, even most universities and business schools now are starting incubators, business incubators, accelerators, and technological trampolines where they can sort of encourage startups and knowledge transfers from their institutions to the economy. So we can, if we look back in the perspective of efficiency, this boom, and we're wondering, well, you know, has there been any thought given to whether all this entrepreneurship in higher education, is it really worthwhile? You know, or as some of these economists were saying, that really most higher education institutions are probably going down the wrong path by promoting entrepreneurship. And their way of thinking is that, well, if higher education is meant for education or for research, then why are we getting into things based on much more applied as entrepreneurship? Isn't there, you know, chambers of commerce? Isn't that the role of chambers of commerce? Isn't that the role more of, you know, the economy at large and not so much on higher education to take care of this? So I'm going to ask you guys to go back to your phones, okay? And I'm going to ask you to answer this question. Okay. Open again. We have, we're putting back in the screen the QR code in case you want to log in again. You have the website and the code. Once you log in here, then it's a matter of answering the questions. It's basically a yes or no question. Yes or no question that you have. You know, are higher education institutions going down the wrong path, according to you, by promoting entrepreneurship? Should they really promote entrepreneurship? Take in consideration, maybe like many universities and business schools that are very expensive and usually are meant to, for business schools, to create managers. Should these managers be detracted towards starting their own businesses? You know, many business schools in France are set up by chambers of commerce as a method of creating managers in order to for their members of the chambers of commerce to be able to have a steady supply of quality trained managers. Well, if the school starts then producing entrepreneurs instead of managers, then instead of contributing to the purpose of the chambers of commerce, we're almost creating competition. So I'd like you to answer. Higher education institutions, are they going down the wrong path by promoting entrepreneurship? Okay, so I'm seeing the results now. We're having about two-thirds, a bit more than two-thirds of the respondents agree with the statement that probably higher education institutions are going down the wrong path by promoting entrepreneurship. Whereas, to the contrary, do we have one-third, now it's going up. It's shifting now. Now it's going to two-thirds the other side. So I'm going to wait a bit more to have more people lock down their votes. Okay, it's switched. No. So now what I'm seeing is that we have the large majority of you guys that believe that no, entrepreneurship should be taught within higher education institutions. It has a place within higher education institutions. So you don't agree with these efficiency economists. We're going to close now the true false. This is what I expected. So that's why I was a bit surprised at the beginning of the survey when the yes were going up. I also personally agree with all of you that entrepreneurship does have its place within higher education institutions. And this is what we're going to be seeing right now. Right now we have the results of 3/4 of you agree with me. 1/4 does not. We're going to close the app now and go back to the presentation. So by going back to presentations, I would say that, you know, we have a 75-25% of people that are agreeing with me, but if we would be asking researchers in entrepreneurship or professors in entrepreneurship, we tend to be very, very biased. You know? In most business schools, in most universities, once you get the entrepreneurship professors, they tend to be the most motivated guy. And often we're almost more entrepreneurship advocates trying to defend the values and promote entrepreneurship rather than really be just simply educators or researchers. And one of the problems that lots of, from the research point of view, that we often lack a bit of the criticism towards entrepreneurship that maybe we should be. Okay, why? Because we understand entrepreneurship, we know what we can get through entrepreneurship, and you have to be very passionate in order to really teach and share that passion with some of our students. But there is a bit of problem with this advocacy. Okay, it was needed maybe in the past when entrepreneurship was very marginalized. I remember in the first time I was employed in a university as a young PhD student, and I was specializing myself in entrepreneurship, the director of the department came to me and said, you know, why don't you specialize in another area of research that's much more promising? You're wasting your talent by doing this entrepreneurship stuff. Because back then it was big business, multinationals, that's what was interesting for the economy. And this thought that entrepreneurship is interesting is very, very new. But the problem of being advocates is that people listen to us. Policymakers end up listening to this entrepreneurship advocacy, and also to a certain extent the presidents of universities and the chancellors of universities and higher education institutions listen to the merits of entrepreneurship that we keep repeating over and over, and they often misinterpret this in seeing that, well, if entrepreneurship is so good, it must be the solution for everything. But the truth is, maybe not. And maybe, you know, researchers in entrepreneurship and also professors in entrepreneurship should maybe tone down their promotion of entrepreneurship now that the message has gone out and entrepreneurship is present in most higher education institutions. It's often best not to create over expectations, because by getting policymakers to think that entrepreneurship is the solution to everything, then we're getting lots of pressures, and especially even from our university presidents and our chancellors, that let's create as much entrepreneurs as possible within our schools and within society. So there's this attitude now that the more the merrier, and everybody has to be an entrepreneur. And this indiscriminate promotion of entrepreneurship is probably not a positive thing. It's not true that everybody should be an entrepreneur. It's not true that everybody is made to be an entrepreneur, and that the more entrepreneurs there are, the better it is for society or for the economy. Just give you a bit of an example. There are negative consequences often of doing over-promotion of entrepreneurship within higher education. Right now, in many of our youth, entrepreneurship has become something that's very romanticized. There's a romance around the entrepreneur, Okay, and this romance basically is setting some people to choose the entrepreneurial path instead of the labor market path that maybe shouldn't do so. Maybe would have their own human capital better optimized if they would have stayed with the labor market. Okay, because there's a certain amount of naivete also associated with entrepreneurship. You know, if they can, I can. I'm going to be the next Bill Gates or Elon Musk, etc. Well, sometimes for certain students, like the students at TBS, which fortunately, because of their training, because of the great extension network that TBS has with the corporate world, we can say that almost 100% of our students have labor market opportunities when they graduate from our programs. Well, by choosing the entrepreneurial path instead of the labor market path, that creates quite an important opportunity cost for those youths. So we have to make sure that if they choose the entrepreneurial path, that it's actually worthwhile for them, especially in a context where it's difficult, the mobility between the entrepreneurial path and the labor market path. Often those have chosen to go down the entrepreneurial path, keeping in mind that from OECD statistics and other research that has been done, most of the students that try to start their own business actually never start anything. And the numbers were around 60 to 70%. And of those 30% or so that do start their business, about 50% actually don't make it past the first 3 years. Okay, so that's the serious statistics to think about. That would mean that roughly only 15% of our students that choose to go down the entrepreneurship path will actually still develop their entrepreneurial career 5 or 6 years down the road. Okay? Whereas if they would have stayed with the labor market path, that path would probably have been guaranteed for them. Okay, so I'm not saying that we should not encourage youth to go down the entrepreneurial path, but we have to make sure that they are well prepared. We have to make sure that they are well trained and that they know what they are getting into and what the opportunity costs are before they do so, instead of simply romanticizing that particular career choice. And also, from a society point of view, we are today in the midst of the digital transformation where knowledge-based economy is what's most important for competitiveness and economic competitiveness. So for an economy to actually see its higher educated youth choose to start employment through an entrepreneurial career instead of the labor market, well, you have to make sure that they will actually start businesses that truly optimizes their own human capital and what they've been prepared doing. I've seen too many times in too many countries where very well-trained, high human capital researchers, PhD students, etc., are caught up with the romance of entrepreneurship and end up starting businesses, legitimate, good businesses, but that simply does not optimize that person's human capital. So from a society point of view, that economy will actually lose human capital injection by having that student go and start their business instead of better optimizing their human capital by working for somebody else. Now, that's not always the case, but we have to make sure that only those students and the projects that they start really are linked with their human capital endowments. Okay, so now, well, policymakers, especially in through the OECD, we're talking a lot with university chancellors, talking a lot with the ministries of education of many different countries and explaining these consequences of entrepreneurship promotion in higher education. And one of the debates that always comes true is that what we need to do is then stimulate much more quality entrepreneurship, okay? But that comes back to the point. Then what is quality entrepreneurship? If governments, if higher education institutions need to promote better quality entrepreneurship, what is quality entrepreneurship? Now, I'm going to ask you guys to answer this question. Please take your phone again, the QR code, if you're not already linked in, and let's answer this. I made this question into a multiple choice questions with three of the options that most often come up when we do our particular debate about this in discussions with government and with universities. You have the option A, is quality entrepreneurship. A is entrepreneurship that generates employment. That's often what policymakers have most in mind when they're thinking of promoting entrepreneurship. They want entrepreneurship that creates lots of employment. B is entrepreneurship that innovates. And that's often what we hear more from university and higher education. They want entrepreneurship that comes out of their institutions, that transfers knowledge, that innovates, that do things that are new. C, entrepreneurship is an entrepreneurship that optimizes the human capital of the person that's starting a business. Okay, that's maybe more linked to what I was just saying right now. And D, entrepreneurship, that quality is an entrepreneurship that is persistent, that survives and perdures in time. Okay? Now, why I'm asking you guys to actually choose between A, B, C, and D is because these different options often contradict each other. If you want an entrepreneurship that generates lots of employment, often what you're creating is an entrepreneurship that does not necessarily optimize the human capital of those employment that you're creating. And often when you're trying to stimulate entrepreneurship that is very innovative, well, you're also creating and stimulating entrepreneurship that's very risky and have much lower probability of surviving and perduring over time. So there are a bit, you have to make your choices where exactly you want to do and why you want to do this. So I'm seeing your answers right now. So according to you guys, what is quality entrepreneurship? You're almost half of you are saying that entrepreneurship of quality is entrepreneurship that innovates. Okay. So you're thinking very similar to one of the policy indications from the European Commission that I worked with a few years back, that in order to allocate subsidies and credit towards new entrepreneurs, it had to be innovative. Problem that happened with that particular policy is that everything ended up being innovative. Putting a restaurant in a corner of a street where there was no restaurant before was legitimately argued that this is innovation because it's something new. There was no restaurant here, now there's a restaurant. So innovation is also, it's a matter of interpretation. What is innovation? But, you know, many people, especially within the higher education institutions, agree with you that entrepreneurship might be innovation, but also might be human capital. I mean, the true thing is that all of these answers are correct. And the thing, it depends a lot in what context you're doing it. So now I'm going to close the app and go back to the presentation where if I give you the answer of what is quality entrepreneurship from the OECD in some of the territorial policy consultancy that we did recently over the last 5 years, well, quality entrepreneurship in a territorial development point of view is entrepreneurship that allows a territory to commercialize its own indigenous resources and capabilities efficiently and sustainably through an optimal use of the region's human capital, whether as entrepreneurs or as employees through the employment opportunities created by those entrepreneurs. So that is finally one definition of quality entrepreneurship, but specifically for territorial development policy. Now, the thing is here is that entrepreneurship is not an ends. It should never be an objective. Entrepreneurship should actually be a tool. It's a means to an objective. And that's what needs to be very well understood and often is not understood enough by policymakers, by presidents of many higher education institutions, and even by researchers too many times that end up putting entrepreneurship as the dependent variable, and set as the independent variable within their research, which means that it's not about how much entrepreneurship you do or, you know, how much entrepreneurship there is coming out of a particular university. It's what do you want to achieve through this entrepreneurship? Okay, from a territorial point of view, again, well, you might want to use entrepreneurship as a means to integrate marginal segments of the population within the economy. You might want to use entrepreneurship as a way to stabilize the demographics of a particular territory and help youths stay within a particular rural area. You might want to use entrepreneurship as a means to create employment, or, as most of you had mentioned before, as a means to inject new knowledge and new innovation within an economy in order to gain competitiveness. Right? But what's important is that entrepreneurship is the tool, not the objective. And just to go back a bit as an example of this, the European Union, the European Commission, all the way back in the year 2000, had set itself the objective of becoming the most competitive and dynamic knowledge-based economy in the world. Okay, there was in 2000, the century, the coming into the new millennium, the European Union was just about to adopt the euro. They were very bullish, and they really believed that, you know, the 20th century was about manufacturing, was about efficiency. That was maybe United States and Asia, but the 21st century, which was going to be about knowledge and more about differentiation, well, that was going to be Europe's game. Unfortunately, very quickly, they realized that no matter how much public transfers and investment were being made in research and development, that knowledge and that innovation was just not reaching the economy. Those countries in the north of Europe that most invested in R&D were the ones that were growing the least within the European Union, whereas the southern economies at that period of time that invested least in R&D were the ones that had very impressive rates of growth. And very quickly, by doing the analysis, the EU and its members realized that there was a missing ingredient here compared to other economies around the world, and that missing ingredient was entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship being the bridge that helps to carry the knowledge that's being created in laboratories, in higher education institutions, and, you know, bring it to the economy and commercialize it and inject it within the economy for the benefits of the general population. So, 2004, 2005, the European Union set up in its Green Book and policy agenda to try to promote entrepreneurship in Europe. And they did it in a very curious way. Their whole strategy was based on promoting the entrepreneurial mindset among EU citizens, businesses, and organizations. So they focused on the mindset. They did not focus on creating new businesses. They simply focused on changing the culture towards an entrepreneurial culture. And this is important because contrary to what they've done in other countries and contrary to what still lots of policymakers and universities interpret of entrepreneurship is that they define it in very different ways. Even with some of your responses when we did the word cloud at the beginning and I asked you to define entrepreneurship in one word, we had a mixture of different definitions of what entrepreneurship is. Actually, from a research point of view, there are two main definitions of what entrepreneurship is. One is an operational definition. Operational definition of entrepreneurship is the entrepreneurial event, it's startup, it's business creation. That's when a new business is created. Okay, and the entrepreneur is the person that creates that business. The behavioral definition of entrepreneurship, which is actually a much older definition of entrepreneurship, is much more linked with innovativeness. And the person who's entrepreneurial is a person that is proactive, that has initiative, that's able to lead new projects into unknown territories. And that's linked also to entrepreneurship, but a behavioral definition of entrepreneurship. Now, higher education institutions, to a certain extent, when they've been thinking of teaching entrepreneurship, And what you see, at least from over the last 10 years, has been lots of teaching of things more linked with an operational definition. How to do a business plan, how to carry out marketing, consumer analysis, digital marketing, etc., etc. But now it's time to change, and some of the newer courses and dynamics in higher education entrepreneurship is much more linked to behavioral and innovativeness of students. And to do that, well, then it's no longer just entrepreneurship that should be taught to those individuals, maybe between that segment of the population of business schools that want to start their own business. But innovativeness, the behavioral definition and interpretation of entrepreneurship, now can be taught throughout all of the university students and different faculties and different departments in a cross-disciplinary way and also in a multidisciplinary way. It's not just about teaching students how to start their businesses. Now it's teaching students how to be much more entrepreneurial in the sense of having initiative, being able to start their own projects, being proactive, being tolerant to ambiguity, etc. Okay? So, and this, how I link it back to the higher education institution, well, this change towards behavioral entrepreneurship is very much linked to the third mission of higher education institutions. Now, there's been a change of paradigm over that same period as entrepreneurship has become more and more popular over the last 20 years for higher education institutions throughout the world, which has been described as the third mission. More and more people are trying to propose that universities and higher education institutions in general have a role to play that goes beyond simply pedagogy, so education and research. And that third mission is all about being key drivers within economic and social development of their communities. Okay? And how they should do that is higher education institutions should stimulate local skill development, not only of their students, but should be also active through extension mechanisms and extension programs to stimulate the human capital development of the people in their community. Also, they need to be active within knowledge exchange. And notice here that it says exchange. It doesn't say simply transfer. Most higher education institutions have set up knowledge transfer programs. But really, it should be about exchange. There is as much to gain by bringing knowledge created in institutions out to the economy as bringing society and businesses into the institutions in favor of research and also pedagogy, also teaching. Okay? And then also community engagement. Instead of living in its silo, in its ivory tower, higher education institutions has to be much more engaging and part of the society and the community in which they are based. And finally, in that also comes in the entrepreneurship and their role in stimulating entrepreneurship within the third mission. Now, that change of paradigm has occurred over the last 20 years or so, the last two decades, and has also coincided with a change in mentality of lots of higher education institutions, where there's been a globalization of higher education and also an increased autonomy of the policies and strategies that are made by higher education institutions. And because of that, there's been growing pressure from a financial point of view, which has led most higher education institutions, when they're talking about the third mission, to put much more priority on the economic development than the social development. And that has transformed itself into many ways into the entrepreneurial university, which is part of almost most strategic plans of higher education institutions throughout the world is the objective and goal to become an entrepreneurial university. But we must keep in mind that the entrepreneurial university has merit, but it does not equate the third mission. Third mission is about developing the economic, but also the social. It's about engagement. It's about exchange. And that's things that, to many extent, a simple entrepreneurial university, at least in the way that's been developed, what often just an operational definition of entrepreneurship has just not been able to reach. So how do you translate that into an institution and into entrepreneurship education? Well, here at TBS, we are basing it a lot on active learning. Okay, we're not alone in that. It comes a lot from the role that we are taking and the inspiration from the OECD, where we looked a bit benchmark what's going on around the world, our collaboration with Babson College. And we see that through active learning, it's no longer just about teaching students what to think, but it's much more about teaching them how to think, and especially how to take action. In the sense that, well, many higher education institutions are very good at teaching recipes, just to use a metaphor, but very few are able to really teach students how to cook. In the sense that to be a good cook, you need to be able to open the fridge, and no matter what ingredients you'll find, you're going to be able to take it out, put it on the table, and be able to create something that's gastronomic out of it, and wow your guests. Well, it's a bit the same. Most of our students, if we just teach them recipes, when they will go into the real world and start their active, either as entrepreneurs or in the labor market as managers, well, most likely they will not find all those ingredients that are in those recipes that we're trying to teach them out of textbooks. So we'd much rather teach them, yes, the recipes are important, but also how to cook. So basically, how to take action is something that's very important and that we like to teach. Now, I'd like to go back to you guys with the app, with your mobile phone. That was the indication of what we needed to do. And I'm going to put the QR code again back in the case you've logged out. I'd like to ask you guys, to you, how should higher education institution, or how in your own schools, how would you teach students how to pass and how to take action? Okay, so I said we want here to teach not only what to think, but most how to think, but especially how to take action. So I'd like you to tell me, just basically write, and you can write a whole sentence here. How should schools teach students how to take action? Okay, so I leave it up to you. Okay, I'm seeing, so hopefully I'm starting to get some of the answers. Develop curiosity, great stuff. You know, so you see, now we're saying to, okay, how to take action, it's entrepreneurship, but developing curiosity actually has nothing to do with starting businesses, but it's essential if we want to actually have, you know, entrepreneurially driven society and entrepreneurially driven employees and managers for the future. Hands-on methodology, action learning, very important. Okay, have group projects to instill collaboration. Obviously, teamwork is very important, and that interaction skills are very important. It's going down very empowerment, intrinsic motivation. They have to really feel that they want to. Very important. And that's very challenging for professors, who especially professors have been taught in a more traditional way of PowerPoints and reading books and multiple choice tests. Well, often that's difficult to stimulate soft skills, but through action learning, and especially through reflection after this action learning, it's very important. So skills transfer, very important. So that calls for probably having some of the professors already having some of these skills. So not just being somebody that repeats what's in the textbooks. Experiential project. I'm a big, big believer in experiential project in many different kinds. Stimulate motivation. That's engagement, which has been very difficult to do. And also at the same time, we have much more tools to engage our students now with all these digital platforms that we're having. You know, changing to Zoom has forced us to use all these different digital tools to engage our students. And that's is stimulating also action learning, focused on implementation as much as strategy and how things happen. Okay, great. I'm having some great, great answers, and you can put a heart between some of these things that you really like, so you can sort of indicate. We might, you know, we're going to keep some of these and come back to them. Great. So let me just tell you now the way that TBS works, but especially what at the OECD we have been developing. So we're going to close the app right now, go back to the presentation. And you have some very good feedback that you've been giving me. I'd be very curious also to see what some of your schools are been doing in order to stimulate this action. From the OECD point of view, we've been developing with the department I collaborate with, which is Entrepreneurship, SMEs, Urban and Regions, together with the education department at the OECD, the people behind the PISA evaluations. Projects around higher entrepreneurship education. And we've developed a bit this model, what they call the onion. I don't know if that's the right representation, but it splits entrepreneurship education into three different levels. And why is that important? Because my experience, or our experience, when we talk with different universities and policymakers, and even with professors in entrepreneurship, when we mention entrepreneurship education, we tend to talk about many different things at once. And when what we're talking about entrepreneurship education as a professor might be very different from what our policymakers or what our presidents of our universities are hearing. Okay, and that's one of the main things that, as for here TBS, we want to make sure that we have very clear is that one, the most important part of entrepreneurship education is those foundational skills. That's level one. Those are those transversal skills that we believe should be taught by all our students. So these are the entrepreneurial or intrapreneurial mindset that are key for all employees, all managers, for their future prosperity and be able to be proactive and value-adding within a knowledge economy. So sense of initiative, proactiveness, tolerance of ambiguity, all those things are these foundational skills. Often they're soft skills, okay? That's the basis of entrepreneurship education. Now we get a level a bit higher, and that's really where the experiential teaching and the action learning comes in, is what we call sandpit pedagogical incubators. This is basically using enterprise or using the business or even challenges as a way to teach. Here at TBS, in our entrepreneurship, social and digital track, we make our students live this experiential training through basically they start from A all the way to Z in starting their own business. From idea, they generate ideas, they go from idea to the model, business model, from business model to plan, from plan to execution, and within that 4 to 6 months, they end up with an actual business. Now, we don't care about the business. The end product is not really the objective. The objective of using these sandpits, pedagogical incubators, is the process. And often there's much more learning that happens when, you know, the students fail and they realize that, you know, this will never work. Well, it's the process that's very important, okay? But we use it here in our entrepreneurship, but we also use it in many other parts of the school as well. We have innovation challenges. We might have, we have strategy simulations. We have, you can have, you know, so, sometimes there's different challenges that could be with coding and other schools can do this, where you're basically setting up a real-life situation or a close-to-real-life simulation that helps the student, so basically project themselves into this atmosphere of action, of experience. And through the experience, and especially if we combine it with reflection, they're going to be able to interiorize some of these soft skills and key foundational skills that are linked with a behavioral entrepreneurship, okay? And then there's a third level of entrepreneurship education, and that's what the OECD calls academic education, Okay, academic entrepreneurship education. And this is really where often when we talk to policymakers, even with university chancellors about entrepreneurship education or entrepreneurship promotion, that's what comes to mind to them right away. And that's, you know, almost just the border. It's just an exception. It's much more marginalized than the foundational skills and even the sandpit education. And that's to help students or faculty or researchers within higher education institutions to launch and grow their own businesses. So this is much more entrepreneurship from an operational definition, and that's what justifies, to a certain extent, the incubators, the accelerators, and some of the technology trampolines that are in within many of the higher education institutions. Okay, but finally, we don't have to limit it only to the third level, to those individuals, those students who want to start their own business. Because finally, having a sense of initiative, being resourceful, being proactive, finally, these are skills that are especially important in this knowledge-based economy that is much more dynamic than what used to be maybe in the 20th century and serves the purpose of entrepreneurs, definitely, but also of most employees within a knowledge-based economy, and also it serves the purpose of citizens and society in general. And this is where that if we really want to reach the third mission that we had explained to you before, and to a certain extent also justify to the efficiency economists of what are the merits of having higher education, higher entrepreneurship education, having entrepreneurship within higher education, and allocating so many resources and human capital to entrepreneurship. Finally, it's all about having higher education institutions become facilitators of an entrepreneurially driven society. Okay? The 21st century needs to be to have a much more entrepreneurially driven society, where things move, where things new projects are developed, where things are able to transition towards the better. Okay, and higher education institutions can have the mandate and should play an important role and contribute to providing the leadership so as to create entrepreneurial thinking, entrepreneurial actions, instill entrepreneurial institutions, and especially optimize that entrepreneurial capital that has been created within the universities, but also within the society in general. So higher entrepreneurship education institutions need to favor the entrepreneurially driven society within their communities, and the communities now with, you know, this digitalization of society doesn't only mean to have their immediate community or from a geographical point of view, but communities can be international communities, can be virtual communities, and could extend much further. Okay, so with this, I wrap up a bit my presentation, and I'm gonna ask you to react and ask your questions. Go back to the app of the mobile. Okay, I'm going to. There we go. You have the app back in, and I'm going to ask you to formulate your questions. So now that Margarita is coming back, I'm going to put back my mask, and we're here to answer your questions, please.
For this last, thank you, Yancy. Please, if you could reconnect to the app with your name and a picture of you, we will. It's for a small surprise after the event, and it will be nicer to know who is making questions and participating. So please connect with name and picture.
Okay, and please give us, you know, questions, comments, impressions. It could be on the presentation, or it could be questions for Margarita and technical questions on TBS in general.
You can either write them on the app, or if you want to connect your micro and raise your voice, whatever you feel more comfortable with.
Okay, so I'm seeing that some questions are starting to come in. Okay, whilst we're waiting for more of them to come in, just to specify that, you know, lots of these things that I explained were on purpose trying to provoke thought and new ways of thinking around entrepreneurship education. Most institutions are transitioning in the right direction. So I'd be curious to know, what is happening from an entrepreneurship point of view in many of your schools, but they're becoming more and more utilized in many different universities, and it's becoming very important for us at TBS to implement it, not only specifically in the entrepreneurship class, but in a transversal manner in all our programs. So
we have the first questions. I think, Yancy, these are for you. Claire? She's asking, at TBS, how do you teach in entrepreneurship that would be different from other schools?
Okay, it's always a bit difficult to know. Maybe, Claire, what are you referring to from other schools? What is your perspective?
I mean, again, I think that entrepreneurship comes really from the intrinsic motivation from students. And so how do you support students? Because sometimes it seems contradictory to have entrepreneurship in the classroom. What are some of the projects or activities that you do that are particular to TBS to promote entrepreneurship, that innovative mindset and curiosity?
Very good question, because it is very difficult, because as you know, many of the skills that we just talked about were, you know, soft skills. They're things that, as an other analogy is, you cannot learn really entrepreneurship by reading a book or seeing a PowerPoint, the same way as you cannot learn to swim by seeing a PowerPoint or reading a book. If you want to learn to swim, you have to jump in the swimming pool. Well, entrepreneurship is pretty much the same thing. You have to get wet. One of the ways that we did, this was actually the kickoff for our entrepreneurship track this year, seeing that we were starting completely online. We had 40 students in the track who did not know each other because they were coming from different faculties, and we had international students also. We decided to throw them in the swimming pool very quickly. And it coincided with the rentrée des profs is the kickoff of the semester that we usually do as an event for the profs and the staff at TBS, which this year was not supposed to happen. Because usually we do something that's really fun, like a casino, we go to the beach, we have a meal. It's sort of a group dynamic activity that we do amongst the staff and teachers at TBS. And this year was going to be canceled. So we decided, no, let's not cancel it. Let's just simply give that challenge to our students. So on the very first day of the semester, new students, they were giving, after presenting the program, they were given the challenge, you have 10 days to conceptualize, organize, and deliver the rentrée des profs, which is basically the group dynamic activity for the kickoff the semester for the profs. And they did an amazing job. Lots of pressure, lots of stress. It was great for group dynamics and group building, where basically we didn't guide them too much. And they decided to have the whole activity online, where the students were teaching the profs of different digital tools that could improve their teaching during the rest of the semester. So lots of the students had to learn themselves these different tools and then had to teach it to the students. Okay, so that's just an example. It's action-based, and then we had good reflection in order to answer. We have a second question.
Yeah, I think it's Tracy. Hi, Tracy. You want to ask yourself the question?
I really struggle with making sure I'm, you know, I know that any student could be an entrepreneur, but are there is there a certain type of student that you find is the most successful coming to your school? Is there a set of traits or, you know, a background of activities or something like that that really, you know, stands out when you're looking at successful students from your school?
Okay. Again, it depends a lot on what definition of entrepreneurship you're looking at. Because it's very different. The student that is interested and really passionate about starting new businesses or new project, they often come in, they have their brilliant idea, and they believe they're going to change the world. And that's different maybe from what we're trying to teach, which is much more the behavioral entrepreneurship. And that often is a different kind of student. We're not leaving apart the people who want to start their own businesses, because we do have our incubator, and we have a TV Start where we're trying to encourage new business creation. But we're trying to also have all the students who may want to become financial experts or accountants, or are very interested in marketing, etc. We're working a lot with them to also develop this resourcefulness, this sense of intuition. Even though they don't really realize that what they're doing, what they're learning, is entrepreneurial skills, because often we don't call it entrepreneurial skills or entrepreneurship as such. It's just integrated into our way of teaching. And to go back to the question we had before, that means being very innovative ourselves in the way we teach, trying to make the students live experiences, many different experiences, and making them reflect on what they've lived, and they realize, it's true, I just learned how to do this. So instead of waiting for the teachers to tell them what they're supposed to be learning, we're just making them live experiences and then making them realize what they've learned by going through these experiences. But it's very difficult. Yeah.
Aaron Jones, you want to make yourself the question?
Hello, I love the idea of entrepreneurship, being an entrepreneur, being creative, innovative, but I'm curious to know, and I'm probably one of those more conservative, pragmatic economists that you're speaking of. Can you talk a little bit more about the ability or the base level of knowledge needed before you could begin to push those boundaries and innovate? Because I agree with your saying about it, but I still sort of, I have this inkling that you need a base level knowledge and understanding before you can begin to innovate and push those boundaries. So can you elaborate a bit on that?
Again, it depends a bit on the, very good question, Dr. Jones, on the type of entrepreneurship you want to stimulate. And in the sense, what the biggest challenge, what's most difficult often, is to stimulate the engagement. Because if you're trying to teach through experience, the students will only get benefit out of it if they live the experience. And for them to live the experience, they have to play the game. They have to be involved and interiorize and participate actively. And that's often the most difficult, especially if we have lower levels, you know, our first year bachelors, where often the level of maturity and what they're expecting, and often this kind of teaching surprises them a lot. But once you're able to get them to engage, and we have many different tools to get them to engage, then it's they don't even realize that they're learning to a certain extent, because it's a different way to go about it. Now, if we would only do that, then it would almost become monotonous, and we would not get that surprise effect that would be very effective. So sometimes we have to alternate and go back, and once in a while have a very traditional class. Because, you know, if everybody is just doing these challenges and these 48 hours and these hackathons, etc., well, then it dilutes. It doesn't have as much impact. So to come back to your question, and also Tracy's question to a certain extent, we're often very surprised with students that come in and, you know, from the first week or 2 weeks, when we're trying to do this, not so much in the entrepreneurship track because they know they chose it, but in the other students, often the reaction is that I'm not interested in that. I just want to be an accountant. I just, you know, I don't care for entrepreneurship and innovation. But once you sort of get them to play the game and engage them, sometimes we're very pleasantly surprised that some of them are like, wow, I love this. You know, I like the leadership. I like to, you know, be engaged and be resourceful. I don't need to wait for people to tell me what to do. I can decide what to do by myself. And that control is often where having students realize that even though they would stay in accounting or in their discipline, now they're probably going to be much more effective accountants because they're going to understand and be much more proactive wherever they work. Okay.
Related to this, I think Paola has something to say. You want to say it yourself, Paola? Hi. I think you have to put your micro on.
Thank you, Margarita. Hi, my question was addressed to the same topic because something that caught my attention is that is the fact that not everyone is an entrepreneur. So what can we do or the institutions do to make the students understand in this world that we are promoting entrepreneurship all the time, that not everyone needs to be an entrepreneur?
I actually have collaborated a lot, and thank you for your question, Paola. And I completely agree with you. I worked with the French government, the Department of Economics and Industry in Bercy, in developing an intrapreneurship strategy for France. So basically, it's, and I've been a bit preaching this to a certain extent, I've written many articles in the Figaro and other newspapers, that business schools specifically, but in general, instead of teaching and promoting only entrepreneurship, and especially in entrepreneurship in the sense of an operational definition, they should talk much more of intrapreneurship, in the sense of making all their employees throughout the entire hierarchy, so all our students, entrepreneurial. As entrepreneurial being a way of thinking, a way of acting, a way of reacting to different challenges and making decisions. And not being only linked to starting a company. So I totally agree with you that not everybody is made to be an entrepreneur. And if everybody was an entrepreneur, economically, it would not be attractive because there would be nobody to work for these entrepreneurs. And curiously enough, there are certain communities that I've seen with my work with the OECD where this actually happens. There's just too many people wanting to be entrepreneurs, and there's nobody left to work for them. Okay, so you don't want that to happen. You want to have employees and you want to have members of society that are entrepreneurial in their way of thinking. So the behavioral way of entrepreneurship. And that's where I think the presentation I did, that third mission, where it comes that higher education institutions, and that's what we're trying to do here at TBS, we're trying to have an impact on our community through our students, but also through our exchange, to trying to stimulate an entrepreneurially driven society. Not just create businesses.
I think we have one more question from Duke Gitonto. Hello, Duke.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor and Ms. Margarita. My question really has been answered partially by the response given to Tracy and also by the last question. Now, I work in India, and in India, really, it's not very easy to tell somebody that not everybody is set up for entrepreneurship, because that is the goal for most students. My current batch of students, actually out of 2016, are really interested in taking a business, and more than half of them are coming to work in the family business. So my question really was, what kind of preparation does a high school student need before they can take up entrepreneurship, probably at TBS?
Okay. Well, basically, we start to a certain extent from scratch. So it's not that there are any prerequisites other than being very open-minded. I think that's one of the most important things, being ready to live the experiences. Because as I said before, if you're closed to living new experiences, then it's going to be very difficult to do action, learning, and make our students live experiences. But when we're talking about foundational skills, my particular opinion is that those foundational skills, entrepreneurship skills, should be taught at a very young age. We should not be waiting to higher education to teach them. I have one local collaborator here in Spain who is an ex-football player, who is one of the promoters of entrepreneurship here in Spain, Perico. And he always says that, you know, if you want to be a high-level international athlete, you need to start training at a very young age. Well, entrepreneurship, from a business creation point of view, is very much in the same way. That if you want to develop those skills, that way of thinking, that initiative, that proactiveness, that leadership skills, it's probably best to start much before you get to higher education level. But if you don't, well, we want, at least here at TBS, to try to stimulate as much your learning throughout the different years that you're going to be here, so that through repetition of different challenges, through different experiences, you're going to have mastered these foundational skills that are linked to entrepreneurship and that will make you a better manager or a better employee or better entrepreneur if that's what you choose to do.
Okay, thank you. I think we don't have any more questions. I don't know if anyone else wanna say something or have any other question. If not, thank you very much for being here. Thank you, Yancy. And we're gonna send you anyway the video that has been recorded of the session. And we are here for anything you need or any question you might have in the future. Just contact us and we'll be happy to help you and talk to you. Thank you very much. And I hope next year this is gonna be a live event and that you might come and see in real life Barcelona, Toulouse and TBS and meet us all. Thank you.
Thank you very much.